So, hello everybody. This is my lecture about electrostatic algorithms. And in this lecture, we will try first to give you a statement of the problem. I will talk about the standard Ewald sum, which has been used like 20 years ago a lot for computation of electrostatic algorithms. Then we will go to our standard workhorse, which is the particle mesh Ewald method, or called P3M. Then I will tell you a little bit about what other kinds of methods there exist and how we can use them via an interface to the Skafakos library. And at the end of this lecture, we will go to more specialized kind of applications, which is how to deal with partially periodic geometries and how to deal with dielectric interfaces. Okay, then let's get started. What is so special about electrostatics? Well, for instance, if you would like to compute the Coulomb energy in any kind of simulation, you can think of doing, let's say, a pair energy summation, but it is a very long range interaction. It's sort of costly because we can't use any of these cutoff schemes, and therefore we always have an n squared kind of cost here. Now, a standard length scale which appears in calculation the Coulomb energies is the so-called Jerome length, which is defined via this expression over here, which is the electrostatic prefactor, which appears here, for instance, in the pair energy summation. And the definition of the Jerome length is simply that if you take two unit charges and you ask for the distance at which they interact with KBT, then this is exactly the Jerome length. And so you can write the pair energy basically with using the Jerome length as your prefactor. And because you divide by an R here, then you're left with some interaction. Now, what you do with pair energies is just as you have learned in standard Coulomb theory, you sum up the 1 over R Coulomb potential by dividing via the distance. And there's a convenient notation that you say, I will exclude the distance where I equals to J, because it would give a zero distance, and therefore then this expression would blow up. So this is an expression for the Coulomb energy, which unfortunately we cannot use if we go to another important consideration, which we do in molecular simulations. Namely, we perform them normally under periodic boundary conditions. Before going to that point, let's look at an alternative route on how to compute the Coulomb energy. And this is not in, let's say, this sort of standard classical particle-based approach, taking the distance of my two charges, dividing by the distance, but it's a potential summation. Let's assume I can compute the potential at each point in space, particularly at the point in space where my charge Q is. Then I can get the total electrostatic energy simply by summing up over all my charges in my system, multiplying by the potential at this point, and divide everything by 1/2. Now, the potential which I would have to use in this part is actually the potential which I would get from solving Poisson's equation, because Poisson's equation basically states that on the left hand side I have the Poisson equation, on the right hand side I have the sources of my field, which are the locations at which my charges reside. And we can prove actually that these two basic ways of computing the Coulomb energy are equivalent approaches. Now, the things become a little bit more non-trivial if I go to periodic boundary conditions. I mean, periodic boundary conditions is basically you always want to do that when you're not interested in really the interactions of objects confined into a very tiny space. So whenever you're interested in bulk properties, and then of course the pair energy summation becomes infinite, because due to the infinite replicas which we have, which behave like a normal additional particle, we have an infinite amount of particles, albeit they are in the space confined by their periodic images. So in principle, we know where all the periodic images are. Nevertheless, in the pair energy summation, you have to sum them up. And you can do this in various ways. And this already brings up the first problem here, the Coulomb energy as a 1 over r kind of function is only conditionally convergent. And this means that the summation order is important, because if you change the order of the summation, that also means that you change the outcome of your sum. So that means the value, which is here on the left-hand side, our desired energy, depends on the way we sum up this infinite sum. And therefore, normally one goes to a standard way and says, I would like to sum up this in a periodic kind of fashion where I go over surrounding cells in this medium. This is saying I sum over shells, which I count from 0 to infinity. Within this shell, the distance vector is constant, and I sum within each shell according to this formula, which says again the prime, that if I and j are equal, then, and if m is equal to 0, then of course I neglect this contribution, because again it would blow up my system. This of course is numerically difficult. You can convince yourself that the number of terms which appear are worse than n squared, because there's a very strong prefactor, and if you say, okay, I don't want to sum my whole thing up, but I just take a few shells, you will still notify this is extremely costly and the sum only converges very slowly. But one thing we should note again here is that U not necessarily is periodic in the coordinates. If you go now to a potential summation approach like before, we again have our equation here, 1/2 sum over q times the potential, but this time it's the potential which we obtain from solving Poisson's equation imposing periodic boundaries. And therefore, phi is periodic, and therefore u is periodic in coordinates. So we have, in principle, the contradicting result that on the left-hand side, we have something which is possibly not periodic, on the right-hand side, something which definitely is periodic. What is the difference? The difference can be actually expressed in terms of a non-periodic term, which is called the dipole term. So this dipole term has a form of dipole, so q times r is a dipole term, which you sum up in this particular form, and there is an epsilon infinity appearing, which means that the idea is that I sum up around my central box here, again in my spherical shells of constant distance, and I assume that on the outside there is some dielectric constant, which I don't know yet, and which I call the dielectric constant at infinity. In the pair energy summation, you would say, okay, I don't have any periodic, I don't have any dielectric medium around there at infinity, so I have vacuum around, so epsilon infinity should be maybe 1. In the potential summation approach is that basically I'm confined within my toroidal sphere, because I have internal periodic geometries. There is basically no outside, and so the epsilon infinity is infinity. As I said, one can mathematically show that this lattice sum on the left-hand side can be made equal to the potential summation when I include this dipole term. So this is basically the difference between the left-hand approach here and the right-hand approach. But you also might have noticed that if I set this epsilon infinity to infinity, actually the dipole term vanishes. And this means that in principle, And there are evil algorithms around which allow you to specify the Dipole term. But the cooking recipe I tell you is that basically always use metallic, so-called metallic boundary conditions, because the dielectric of a metallic is infinity, because that's always safe, and never use, especially never use any value for lower than infinity for conducting systems. So in principle, all this confusing slides is telling you that if there's a dipole term in your eval sum, please never add it to your computations, because please assume always epsilon infinity being equal to infinity. Then you're on the safe side. Now, let's talk a little bit about the standard Ewald method. This is already has been around for a long time, and it's due to Paul Peter Ewald, who was actually a professor here in Stuttgart, and he was working on the theory of X-ray crystallography. So you might think, well, at that time, computers were not really in existence. So what kind of idea, or what did he want to do with this Ewald sum? Well, he wanted to compute the infinite Coulomb energy, actually, to understand the stability of crystals. So that gave rise to the Madelung constant of crystals. Now, if you think a little bit about what is the problem of the Coulomb sum, then it's this 1 over r behavior, basically. This means, first of all, the Coulomb potential is singular at each particle position, because if I go r equals to 0, then it diverges. And 1 over r potential is very slowly decaying. That means you have to go out very far in order to get only small contributions from your potential. Now, the solution to the idea is basically separate these two problems. And what it will end up is actually that you will calculate the fast decaying short range part in what's called the real space, because there the potential really decays very fast, which is very nice. And you will calculate the smooth tail in Fourier space. And while we're doing this, we will actually convert the sum into two exponentially converging sums. How does this trick work? Well, the idea is that you split the potential. If you think about, we have a bunch of point charges which are located in space. So here we have n of them located at these points Ri. Then you would get a potential which has singularities, let's say a positive one here, negative one here, if you just look at the one-dimensional case, and you say, I now try to dress these charges mathematically by smearing them out. And this means I will add a Gaussian, well, what I would like to have is basically get a smeared out distribution of my original charges. But this I can only get if I basically add a smearing charge, which is of the opposite sign. And I have already, I basically have to add a zero is what it means. So I add a Gaussian positive at this position and also a Gaussian negative at this position. Now, why do I use Gaussian? Well, there's nothing magic about Gaussian, and but Gaussian have a nice mathematical property, namely if you take the Fourier transform of Gaussian, you get another Gaussian. So therefore, you have one parameter, of course, in Gaussians, namely that is the width of your Gaussian, and this is determined by this parameter alpha here. Now, the charge distribution then basically looks like this. Instead of our delta function, I have a Gaussian, which is, let's say, positive, and I have a Gaussian, which is negative, which I subtract. So in an order, I mean, this is because it's negative, it's the minus sign. So the sum of both is zero, and I'm left with my delta function. But I have now this blue part, a smeared out charge distribution, and I have this red one, which is also a smeared out charge distribution with some other sign in front of it. Now, the split of this potential, as innocent as it looks like, it allows us actually to express these terms in very nice mathematical forms. So if you look in the book by Frankel and Smith, there is basically a nice mathematically easy way of to follow of how this really works with the split of the potential and how the mathematics behind that is. But the whole energy, you will be able to replace it as the sum of these four terms. One of these term we already discarded in the beginning. Remember a few slides back, I said there's a dipole term, which looks like this, and I suggested always take the dipole term equals to zero by going to metallic boundary conditions. So there are actually just three left here. And the first energy part is called the real space energy. And the complementary error function, which appears here, is basically in the form of a Gaussian. And so that is the real space sum. And there we sum over our spherical shells, over our charges in this in the central box. And it's Q times I times Qj. We divide by the distance, but we are exponentially basically suppressed by this error function term. Then we have a term which is called the energy in real space, because we calculate that in Fourier space. And also in Fourier space, we have now to calculate over the structure factor here. This is basically the Fourier transform of our charge distribution. And again, it's suppressed by an exponential factor, which goes like minus k squared. That means the higher k modes are exponentially suppressed. And it is basically what happens here, that from a slowly convergent sum, we ended up in one sum, which we sum in real space, which is exponentially converging. We have a real space, a k-space sum, which again is exponentially convergent. And we have a third term, which is basically constant. This is originates from the Gaussian self-interaction, which is not R-dependent. And so therefore, if we differentiate that term, it doesn't contribute to the forces. So contributing to the forces are really just the first two parts here, the real space sum and the Fourier space sum. Now the complexity, if you actually do the correct thing, that for increasing number of charges, you will accordingly decrease the cutoffs, will scale like of the order n to the 3 over 2. So it's not quadratic, but it's also not close to linear. And it's actually too slow to make a meaningful simulation with many charges. So therefore, one has to revert to something better. And this better is the so-called P3M algorithm. Let me think if I should tell you one more thing. Yes, the one thing is, of course, that the mathematical structure of the Ewald formula is such that you are mathematically equivalent as long as you do the summations up to infinity. So if you go over all images, if you go over all k-space vectors, then the sum is exact for any value of alpha. But now the trick is, of course, you want to do this reasonably fast on a computer. This means you have to cut off each of these two sums at certain values. At certain values in R, which is the so-called real space cutoff, and at some value in K, which is the Fourier space cutoff. How you cut off these sums will determine how accurate you are, and the accuracy will also depend on the value of the width of your Gaussian distribution, and that to that we will come later. But let's take a look now first to the P3M. Now, the P3M is one of the particle mesh Ewald methods, and the P3M was really first discussed by Hockney and Eastwood, and not even in 1988, but as early as 1973. And so it's basically the oldest particle mesh Ewald method. So these guys, Hockney and Eastwood, really wrote what I would call the Bible, because it contained many nice ways of doing computer simulations for charged particles. but it's a very heavy book to read. Now, what they suggested is that if you are in the near field, if you're interested in the real space sum, use the expression of the standard Ewald sum. But for the far field, replace the Fourier space sum by the discrete fast Fourier transform on a regular mesh. In this way, you can actually reduce the computational order to something which is of the order n log n. And this is for the most cases where we look at in soft matter systems scales almost linearly. However, I told you already that this Bible was written in a language heavy mathematically. And so many people didn't understand it. And so the wheel got reinvented by the particle mesh Ewald method by Darden in 1993. And then later they figured out that the PME was really not really working very well. So they constructed something which they called the smooth particle mesh Ewald method. And in this method, they actually constructed something which is very close to the original P3M. But as I will try to tell you later, the original idea of P3M is still unbeatable. And so because they use an analytically expression for minimizing errors, the P3M is really simply the best method of the particle mesh Ewald methods, and mathematically there can't be anything better. And if you are interested in that, you can read this article where we actually looked at all three algorithms and showed the similarities and the differences. We go through the steps of the P3M, particle mesh. Because you don't have a continuous Fourier transformation anymore, you have to interpolate your charges onto a discrete mesh. In order to interpolate the charges onto the mesh points, you use so-called window functions, and for P3M, these are so-called cardinal B-splines. Now, once you have your charges onto a grid, you can do a fast Fourier transform of the charge distribution. Once you have done that, you can solve Poisson's equation by multiplication with what is called the optimal influence function. I will tell you later what that is. In continuum, what you would do at this point is you would just use a product of the Green's function and the Fourier transform of Gaussian's. And then what you can do is you can obtain the field, the electric field, by Fourier space differentiation. And Fourier space differentiation is very easy because you just multiply times I to the k vector. And then when you have the field on the grid, you Fourier transform the field back. And then you have the real space field on the grid. And because you don't want to have it only on the grid, you have to interpolate the field at position where the charges are and obtain the forces as Q I times EI. I mean, there are various ways of doing this. You don't have to do a Fourier space differentiation. You can also do a so-called IK differentiation or use finite differences. So there are various ways of doing that. And so that was basically the good idea of let's say, Darden in their smooth particle mesh Ewald, where they showed you how we can save a few Fourier fast transforms. And so this was the P3M in a nutshell. And now let's take a look a little bit more in detail how the charge, so-called charge assignment goes. So again, the charge assignment is I have a charge somewhere in space and I need to interpolate now the charge somehow on my nearest grid points. I could take the nearest one, but that would not be very good. So one normally does it and distribute this charge on several of the near ones. And so I can take certain order of these B splines. And the P, which you see here for these cardinal B splines, that is basically the order of the interpolation scheme. And as you see, there are this triangular distribution, and then there are various continuous ways of distributing the charge on either the two neighboring ones, the next two neighboring ones, and then 3, 4, 5, 6. So the p-value basically tells you on how many charges I will distribute my charge in my Fourier grid. And now it becomes, let's say, more and more accurate the more I distribute my charges. On the other way, it becomes more and more costly, because I not only need to distribute the charge on the grids, I also need to pull them back, and this scales cubic in the number of grid points, and therefore I have to look for some reasonable value, in the best case, of course, for the optimal value of accuracy and speed. Now, I was mentioning that there was this funny name, the optimal influence function, appearing in the particle mesh, in the P3M method. And the optimal influence function was the big analytic thing obtained by Hockney and Eastwood, because it's sort of, easily spoken, it's the optimal Green's function, which minimizes a certain error functional. And the error functional basically was constructed here on the top in the way that you say, okay, I take my lattice potential, which I obtain by using some functional form of this G. I compare it with the analytic reference potential, which I know from continuum physics. And then I average all the positions where my charge could be located in the grid, and I moreover averages another time over all positions where my grid points could be. And now the funny thing is that I can functionally minimize this kind of error functional in such a way that I end up at the end of this minimization procedure with an analytic optimal Green's function. And that is the Green's function down here, which for B-splines, for the window function B-splines, looks exactly like this. This means there can't be any better choice of a Green's function that gives me a smaller error functional. And because this error functional is like the root mean squared error, so to speak, by mathematical construction, I can't really find a better way of avoiding lattice artifacts than using this Green's function. And this is why I'm saying the P3M is really the best algorithm, because it makes the least amount of mistakes here. Now, let's come back to errors, because errors are really important for this sort of Coulomb algorithms, because we can never be exact, because we have to use cutoffs of our infinite sums. Otherwise, we would not be able to compute these sums in reasonable time. And therefore, we have to, or let's say it's wise to rethink of how can I make use of my mathematical formulas in such a way that I obtain a certain amount of error, which I say, okay, I allow an error of 10 to the minus 4, let's say, but under which circumstances is my sum fastest and still obeys this 10 to the minus 4 error? So the error we are going to talk about is always the root mean squared force error, because we are mostly interested in molecular dynamics. So there the forces are important. So we use the RMS error. Now, for the standard Ewald method, which is plotted here, we basically have the real space cutoff. So how far do I go out in order to compute the real space energy? We have the K space cutoff, which means how far in Fourier space do I go out to sum up my Fourier space. And then I still have, as a third parameter, the width of my Gaussian distribution by which I can play around. Now, for the standard Ewald method, Kolaffer and Peram have actually showed us how to compute the errors, because the sums which I cut off I can say, okay, from the cutoff to infinity, I mean, how much is left there? I can transform the discrete sum into an integral, and I can really do the integration. And therefore, I get error formulas for the cutoff errors in the real space and the Fourier space sum. And so for certain values, you see how these formulas look like. So they drop exponentially down here, and they increase exponentially in a way also here. And they depend on alpha, because the shape of my Gaussian is very important, as you see, because what you want is basically that you would that you're looking for a point where the real space and the Fourier space error is equal, because that would be your error level. And this is, in this case here, very small for k equals 10 and r max equals 2. But if I'm saying, okay, because naively you could say, well, let's just take a large r max and a large k max, and this is always good. But as you see, it's not always good, because here I use the same k max from the blue and the red one. And where my error is actually depends very sensitively here on the value of alpha. So I do not only need to consider an R cutoff and a K cutoff. I also need to consider that my corresponding alpha value is in the same region, because otherwise it doesn't make sense. If I now would, instead of here on the optimal alpha, I would simulate at this one, I would have an error which is in this case two orders of magnitude larger, although I just changed my alpha from 1.7 to 2.7. So that means the optimal alpha brings orders of magnitude of accuracy. And of course, this again leads back to the optimization problem. With my choice of alphas and R cutoff and K cutoff, I can also ask, can I do the same accuracy now faster or slower? And in order to say something about faster and slower, you always have to compare the algorithm at the same accuracy. Now, the error control, which I showed you here in case of Ewald, can also be brought back to the P3M. Here, again, I show you how the error formulas look like. Kolaffer and Peram had this value. They also had a value for the standard Ewald sum, but the important part is now also for the P3M, you can obtain an error formula. And this involves basically the value Q evaluated for the optimal Green's function of Hockney and Eastwood. Never mind how we got there. There's a little bit of mathematics involved, but there exists an error formula for P3M. And again, this is the large strength about the P3M. And again, in this article, which is a different article from the one I said before, you can see how this error formulation works. And again, now we can, I go back here. We can actually control the errors. We have an additional parameter now in the P3M, which is the order of the B splines. So we not only have the real space cutoff and the Fourier space cutoff, which is basically the length of your Fourier grid. The longer the grid is, the more accurate you get normally, but it also costs you more computer time, and therefore you would like to find the optimum now as a function of four parameters: real space cutoff, Fourier space cutoff, the alpha of your Gaussian width, and then the order of your B splines. And again, there are analytic error formulas which help you in formulating where the optimum is. And Espresso actually has all that coded into its machinery, so that you only have to specify the accuracy at which you would like to work. And then we have an optimization routine in the back, which then figures out for you what are the optimal parameters by which you can achieve this according on the machine you're currently working on, by making educated guesses for the parameters such that they work at equal accuracy, but then these parameters might perform differently on various architectures. Now, I explained to you how the P3M works, and the P3M algorithm really is the workhorse for our electrostatics simulations. But there are, of course, many alternative ways of dealing with the Coulomb sum around. And because you might be interested in sometimes in using a different method, Espresso provides an interface to the SCAFACOS library. So SCAFACOS stands for Scalable Fast Coulomb Solver, a library which you find under www.scafacos.de. And we have been implementing with a lot of other guys various methods and did a paper on comparing the scaling and accuracy and speed parameters of these methods. And currently it provides 11 methods implementations, and there's basically here the direct summation, very slow, but sometimes good for gauging your algorithm, the standard Ewald, the P3M, then something which is called the P2NFFT, which is very close to P3M in all respects, then a multigrid solver, another multigrid solver, a tree level method, the Pepsi, a fast multiple methods, and then some other specialized versions. You can look at the paper and you can say, well, if you would be interested in learning something else, it might be a good way of looking into that. I won't really go in any of these details. The only thing I'm right now interested is to tell you a little bit about partially periodic systems, because they also occur every once and now. And for examples for 2D periodic systems, there are slab-like systems. For instance, if you think you have a membrane and you are only interested in very small parts in front of a membrane, then this looks like an infinite plane, and you can actually very efficiently simulate the systems by using in the half space, so an infinitely slab-like system. And for this, however, the electrostatic interactions need to be treated differently, because now basically you only have two periodic dimensions, and the perpendicular dimension here to the slab is of course finite, and you do not want that you actually take into account interactions between this box and an artificial replica. Now, because the Ewald sum actually converges very badly for such systems, it is actually more difficult to deal with partially periodic systems than with fully 3D periodic systems. There are special algorithms around to treat with these. Now, the simplest way is actually to approximate two-dimensional periodic boundary conditions with a three-dimensional periodic boundary solver like P3M, and to add one very simple term, which is called the Yee and Berkowitz correction. So let's look how this looks like. We have our slab system, which contains the charges, a charge neutral system, which we are interested in computing the interactions with. Now, a very simple idea was, okay, if I use a three-dimensional solver, why not leave a gap here of certain distance? And I do this because I'm replicating in the perpendicular dimension. There's a same kind of replicated slab system here. And if the gap is big enough, and this is a charge neutral system, you might argue that, well, it doesn't have a monopole term. It only has dipole terms which can interact. And therefore, if the gap is big enough, my interactions in the slab here should be almost as good as if I would have no periodic images. This is, of course, understandable that you think this way, but it's in a way wrong, because you have an infinite amount of replicas. this really never decays to zero, no matter how long you make the slab in between. Now, there is a simple way of improving the situation, and this is basically the Yee and Berkowitz correction, namely, which says, well, a good thing of doing this is actually that I, first of all, just sum up all the interactions within one slab, and I sum up really going to infinity from left to right. And then once I have summed up all the interactions, then I go one step further and sum up in this direction. And the change in summation order, so note this is no longer going in spherical shells here like you would do in the normal Ewald sum. No, this is now going in this slab-wise fashion. And you can actually change the summation order, this you can mathematically show, by a simple change in the dipole term, because the dipole term has also something to do with the summation order, as I tried to motivate in one of my first slides. And the change in the dipole term is very simple, because there's no longer an R here like it would be for the normal dipole term. There's a Z here, which is now the Z direction of my slab systems. And this is all you have to do to correct for the, to go from the three-dimensional periodic boundary condition P3M, let's say, to the Yee and Berkowitz case. Now, this change in summation order, meaning just a single line basically on a computer program, already improves the accuracy of the slab systems considerably. But this is not all. You can do much better. And this much better is the so-called ELK method. Although this looks here very intriguing, this is not why we called it the ELK method. But the ELK term is called ELK term because it stands for electrostatic layer correction. And this layer correction is actually, again, an infinite summed term, which has the which can be shown to basically is exactly equal to the interactions your central slab system has with all the other images. So therefore, if you can compute this term efficiently and then subtract it from your interaction energy of your fully three-dimensional solver, then you are only left with the interactions of all the charges within your slab. And the nice feature is that this term, although it looks like an infinite sum, you can, again, by some tricks, compute it in an order which is linear in the number of charges. And because this term is exact, I can also approximate this term at any accuracy I like. And this now allows to calculate the contribution of the image layers almost exactly, and I subtract numerically my energy, and this allows me actually that I don't have to go to this large layer separations in order to reduce the errors. I also do the change summation order with the dipole term, and so at the end of the day, it's about 2 to 4 times faster than the plain Berkowitz method. Plus, I have full error control, and also, because the error is not homogeneously distributed around my slab in the Yee and Berkowitz method, I will actually find out that near the boundaries, I have the largest error, whereas our electrostatic layer correction method basically can reduce the errors which you do down to zero. Now, I just talked about Coulomb interactions, but of course, sometimes you're also interested in dipolar interactions, like in the cases for our ferrofluids. For this case, it's very simple to also formulate the P3M for dipolar systems, because you can basically go from Coulomb systems to dipolar systems by replacing everywhere where a Q is by the derivative with respect to the magnetic moment. And there's also a 2D plus H version, so that means a slab version of this electrostatic layer term, which is known as the dipolar layer correction. So now we can do very fast Coulomb methods or dipolar methods in also in partially periodic geometries. Now I would like to go to my last point and to show you how to include dielectric interfaces. And first of all, let's ask the question, where does this matter, or where do these dielectric interfaces come from? If you're interested in the algorithms, please take a look at this paper, which I mentioned down here. It basically, dielectric interfaces appear normally only when you do coarse-grained modeling of system. So let's assume we have charges which live in a dielectric medium of epsilon equals 80, so our implicit water model, and we have some other regions of lower dielectric, for instance, a solid-state membrane, which has epsilon, let's say, equals to 2, then you have dielectric interfaces because your charges are living mostly here in the water, but when they come close to this bulky material of epsilon equals 2, there might be interactions. Now we know this from, let's say, our electrostatic knowledge, maybe in physics, that whenever you have, when you look at the potential distribution of a charge in front of a wall or a dielectric interface, then you have dielectric boundary forces. That means the charge which resides here at the interface, and this can be calculated via the method of images, is that you will induce an image charge in this wall, which if the dielectric interface is going from a high dielectric to a low, has the same sign. So that means when I come close to the dielectric interface phase, I will experience image charge repulsion. And on the other hand, if I have a charge which comes close to a metal wall, then I will see image charge attraction. Now, the question is, how can I now introduce these effects? How can I specify boundaries with a specified dielectric contrast? In the normal P3M, that is not really possible. So we have to go to use some tricks. Now, in order to compute this efficiently, you can either use image charges like the ones I was showing you up here, or you compute induced charges. So let's look at planar dielectric interfaces that can be actually efficiently handled by two methods, which are called ICMMM2D, which is image charge, and MMM2D is another planar 2D summation method, which is very accurate, but kind of costly. So it's basically only for reference purposes nowadays included. And the other one is the LCIC, which stands for electrostatic layer correction with induced with image charges. So that is basically for planar surfaces the fastest method of introducing these image force effects. But what to do when you have arbitrary curved interfaces? Planar ones I showed you, and there's a fast method. But for arbitrary curved interfaces like a nanopore, it becomes more tricky to do this. For this, we developed the so-called ICC star algorithm, which is based on the following trick. If you look what the boundary conditions for the normal component of the electric field are, then they look rather simple. On one hand side, the normal of the electric field, you multiply with E1, the one dielectric constant of your one slab, and on the other side you have epsilon 2, and that has to be fulfilled by basic electrostatics. Now you ask, how can I fulfill this boundary condition? You can fulfill this by introducing a charge density, which you can simply compute, which has to look like this. And now the idea is I discretize my surface to contain boundary elements on which I put point charges which should have exactly this kind of value. And because I don't know the values, I can't always compute my E. I do this iteratively. So what this means is this discretization of the surface to these boundary elements leads to a set of equations, which you then try to solve iteratively, because you first say, I just put down, let's say, a random or a constant set of charges sigma I. I compute what kind of electrostatic fields I generate with those. If they don't fulfill the boundary conditions, I set up equations which automatically bring me down to the minimum, such that I have charges sitting there which approximately fulfill this boundary condition up to a certain error. Now, this algorithm we termed induced charge computation. The star stands that the method ICC is basically here, but by which method you compute the electrostatic field is completely up to you. So this is where the star comes into play. And normally we do this with P3M, but you can do this with any kind of solver you like, fast multiple method, or you name it, what is fastest under these conditions. Now I'm done with everything. Hopefully my conclusions are there exist plenty of Coulomb algorithms, but you should choose the one which has a decent scaling or a small prefactor depending on the number of charges. And the other important thing I try to get across is that you should use a method which has error control and also formulas, because that allows you in turn to optimize your method under all circumstances. In principle, it's always safe to use the method you know best, because in electrostatics, there are lots of things you can do wrong, or you just choose parameters which are neither accurate nor fast. So we worked on electrostatic algorithms basically almost 20 years from now, and so there are plenty of people who contribute to that. And at the end, I'm not sure if you liked the lecture or you're just glad it's over. But this lecture is supposed to give you some overview, and hopefully in Espresso, there are very simple ways of incorporating them and which work down under the hood without having to know too much how they should work. But this lecture should give you at least a glimpse that you can have a feeling of how they work. So thank you very much.